chapter. But for those of you who were here last week, anybody have any holdover things? We did not get the entire second chapter discussed. But if you've got any questions or any holdovers from the second chapter, anybody got anything? All right. Then we'll go right into chapter 3. Now, I want to relieve any fears you may have, because you may know that this is where the genealogy is. We are only reading the first verse that sort of introduces the genealogy, and then we are skipping the reading of all the names, not because that's not important, but because, well, I think you know why, and we'll pick it up, pick the discussion up after that. So, all right, questions? All right, who's got the first one? Ryan. Thank you, sir. Who begins at number 7? Go ahead, Preston.
He said, therefore, to the multitudes who went out to be baptized by him, you offspring of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Therefore, produce fruits worthy of repentance, and don't begin to say among yourselves, we have Abraham for our father, for I tell you that God is able to raise up children to Abraham from these stones. Even now the axe also lies at the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, that does not produce good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. The multitudes asked him, what then must we do? He answered them, he who has two coats, let him give to one who has none. He who has food, let him do so, let him do likewise. Tax collectors also came to be baptized, and they said to him, teacher, what must we do? He said to them, collect no more than that which is appointed you. Soldiers who asked him, saying, what about us? What must we do? He said to them, extort from no one by violence, neither accuse anyone wrongfully, be content with your wages.
Now while the people were in the state of expectation, and all were wondering in their hearts about John as to whether he was the Christ, John answered and said to them, as for me, I baptize you with water, but one is coming who is mightier than I, and I am not fit to untie the thong of his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and to thoroughly clear his threshing floor, and to gather the wheat into his barn, but he will burn up chaff and unquenchable fire.
And with many exhortations he preached to the people. But Herod the Tetrarch, being rebuked by him concerning Herodias, his brother, Philip's wife, and for all the evils which Herod had done, also added this above all, that he might shut John up in prison. Now when the people were baptized, it came to pass that Jesus also was baptized. And while he prayed, the heavens was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended in a bodily form like a dove upon him. And a voice came from heaven which said, you are my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Now Jesus himself began his ministry at about 30 years of age, being, as was supposed, the son of Joseph, the son of Heli.
And that's where we're stopping the rest of it. excellent information that needs to be here, but we will not read that tonight. Hope you're comfortable with not reading the genealogy. The reason we're not reading it is because I'm going to have you memorize it for next week. So. All right, take a look at that first verse. Just one verse. How many public officials known to the populace does Luke name? All right, count them. In the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, that's one, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea and Herod was tetrarch of Galilee, how many is that? That's three so far. And his brother Philip was tetrarch of the region of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Lysanias was tetrarch of Abilene. You didn't know there were any Roman procurators in Texas in the first century, did you? Five, why in the world does God's Holy Spirit inspire Luke, as he's writing this account, to put down five known officials about which, if he were writing on his own, he could be mistaken? What year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar? 15th year. When you start reading ancient documents that are recording history, it's very common to find mistakes. Hardly ever do you find a document that is completely without mistakes, historically, geographically, linguistically. They've all got mistakes. Some of them terribly glaring, but not so. Not so with the records we find in Scripture. So there are five officials here named that everyone would have known about, that you could go back and you could check the records and you could find out whether or not he's writing accurately, and boom, he's always right on point. Why do you think God would have Luke do this? And I'm asking for speculation because there's no verse that says, here's why God did this. To me, that's the issue right there. This is a valid record. If Luke were mistaken about the historic details, what would be the implication?
Translation where it says when he was baptized, the Spirit of God in the form of a dove lit on his shoulder and said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased, hear ye him." So we're looking at a shift, you know, of fulfillment, but yet, and then if he names off all these other people, of course, there's different accounts, there's four different accounts. He's trying to show them this guy's important.
Okay. Valid, legitimate, it's all right here. You can go to this and you can see, all right, Luke did not skimp out on research. He did his research. He knew who was in power, what year it was in the reign of Tiberius Caesar. All of these people who were involved. By the way, did you notice he mentions in particular Herod and his brother Philip? Why would he mention Herod and his brother Philip in the first part of the chapter? Because he's going to mention him in a few more verses when John gets up in... Who is it, a British saying, get up in somebody's nose? I think it is. And what was that all about? Well, Herod had his brother Philip's wife. And John did not go quietly by in the night and say, well, we won't even bring any attention to that. He confronts him so openly that Herod evidently feels he's got to do something about this. We can talk more about that later, but I just wanted to draw your attention to the fact that Luke doesn't just throw this in here for nothing. There's all kinds of possible reasons, much less the one we see later in the text. Yes. The notation of the Roman authorities would have been, anybody who read this with a Roman background or a Greek background would have understood, okay, that those are the guys in charge. But anybody of a Jewish background, oh, he's even throwing in the high priests, the accuracy of who was high priest. And it's not just the Jewish idea of accuracy of the high priest. Who appointed the high priests? Governors, tetrarchs, political authorities by this time were the ones putting the high priests in position. Why in the world would that be? Why would the Roman authorities care who was the high priest?
Civil obedience.
That's really what it comes down to. And I'm saying that from a perspective of deduction. Not only deduction. Because who were the Jews going to listen to when it came to their response to the Roman rule? They were going to listen to the priests. If the priest told them, we need to up and rebel, it's God's way to rebel, then there would have been a rebellion. But if the priests are appointed by the Romans because they have some kind of a political relationship with them, then there might be peace. Observations, questions?
Yeah, I may have misspoke a while ago when he came up out of the water after he was baptized, and it said, listen to him, that may be another account. Later on.
Well, you just be careful now, Preston, because I'm kidding you, brother. No, when you read, it's in this text right here, in verse 21. When all the people were baptized, Jesus was also baptized, and while he was praying, heaven was opened, and the Spirit descended upon him bodily like a dove, and a voice came out from heaven, you are my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. When you look at Mark's account in chapter 1, verse 9, in those days Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Immediately coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens opening and the Spirit like a dove descending upon him, and a voice came out of the heavens, you're my beloved Son, and you in whom I'm well pleased. Immediately the Spirit impelled him to go out into the wilderness, and he was in the wilderness 40 days being tempted by Satan, and he was with wild beasts and the angels were ministering to him. So when was it that God said, this is my beloved Son, hear him? That's when it was. But it was a significant, a climactic point, the Mount of Transfiguration. Jesus went up there. Who did he take with him? Well, now that's who he saw up there. Man, that was my next question. You're getting ahead of me now. Who did he take with him? Peter, James, and John. He always took Peter, James, and John. Can you imagine the other apostles? Great, there he goes, Peter, James, and John again. What are us? We Swiss cheese or something? Anyway, he goes up there with Peter, James, and John, and he is transfigured. He's transformed. His appearance changes before their eyes. And then they see, Ryan, Moses and Elijah. What's that?
Nothing.
No, that's something. If you're saying it, it's got to be something.
I took in the question too soon and didn't process it.
Boy, well, you go sit with Preston then, okay? Now think about this. What happened to Moses? Did Moses go into the promised land? See, we read this about Moses. Oh, man, he failed to give God the glory, and so God said, sorry, Moses, you're not going into the promised land. Who buried Moses' body? It was God. God essentially became his undertaker. And then we read in Jude about how the devil disputed about the body of Moses, and Michael did not bring a railing accusation against him. And at any rate, that's what we see there. But lo and behold, when Jesus appears transfigured on this mountain, who's with him but Moses? And, of course, Elijah. What's the significance of Elijah? Absolutely. When God sent a prophet, who'd he send to prepare the way for the Lord? We just read about it 2 weeks ago. John the Baptist in the spirit of Elijah, in the spirit and power of Elijah. Now, there's no text that says, now here's exactly why God had Moses and Elijah on the Mountain of Transfiguration with Jesus. It's left up to us to decide. Wow, but it seems pretty obvious to me. These are two very leading figures, literally and figuratively, in the history of the Jewish people. Moses, the lawgiver, the one who was, we might even think, fallen out of favor with God in the end, but you think about it, wow, God says, don't you worry about his body. I'm going to take care of his body. You're with me, Moses. And he didn't go into the promised land, but where did he go? I would think when he died and he opened up his eyes in the presence of God, it's like, well, who cares about the promised land now? That's it. That's what we're working for. And when I say work, I don't mean trying to earn. I mean we're involving ourselves in the works of God so that we might inherit that grandness, that glory. Now, I know there's a reason why I got off on this. But anyway, we'll just come back. The baptism. This is one of those places where, well, it's really the only place where we see all three together in a form that's observable to people. Did you see God? You heard God. You observe the voice, so to speak. The Spirit came down in the form of a dove, and the Son was the one who had been made flesh, came as a human. All three of them are right there. The Spirit descends on the Son. And remember, Jesus will later say, I'm leaving, but I'm not leaving you as orphans. What's he going to do? He's going to send the Holy Spirit. He's going to be your comforter. He's going to guide you into all truth. He's going to show you everything I've taught you in the last 3 years. That's what he was going to do with the Holy Spirit. Jesus even said, it's better for you that I go away, because if I don't go away, the Holy Spirit won't be coming and doing all these things. And I don't know all the ins and outs of that, why Jesus and the Holy Spirit wouldn't both be there. But apparently there was a planned, intended function, and this is going to work the way it's planned to work. And so Jesus was going to leave, and the Holy Spirit was going to come, and everything would be as it should. And everything was as it was supposed to be. That same question is coming up in this chapter on a slightly different level, but I think parallel. What did John say of himself with regard to Jesus? He must increase, John said of Jesus. I must decrease. John says in this text, chapter 3, let's see, where is it? Verse 16, as for me, I baptize you with water, but one's coming who is mightier than I, and I'm not fit to untie the thong of his sandals. That was John's view of the Messiah, of his cousin. They were cousins. John 6 months older than Jesus. If you're looking only at their physical time on the earth. How much older than John was Jesus actually? Remember, Jesus is the one who said, before Abraham was, I am. Which in itself was a declaration of his divinity. And the Jews knew that. That's why at that point they picked up stones to throw at Jesus, because they knew when he said that, before Abraham was, I am, he was claiming to be the I am, equal with God. Well, he was God. And so that's why they picked up stones and tried to kill him, because they considered that blasphemy. All right, let's go back to chapter 3 and verse 2. Check out chapter 3 and verse 2. If the word of God came to John to tell him what to say, do you suppose it also came to John to tell him what to do? What am I asking for? Speculation. Because we don't know. I would think so. I don't think that John was doing what he did on his own And one of the reasons is a question that would come up later. Let's see, I think I put a note down here. Is it chapter 20? I think it is. Luke chapter 20. If you want to flip over to Luke 20, that's okay. This is, after all, a Bible study. Luke chapter 20, verse 1. On one of the days while he was teaching the people in the temple and preaching the gospel, the chief priests and scribes with the elders confronted him. You see that on every page of the gospels nearly. Somebody's confronting Jesus. And they spoke, saying to him, "Tell us by what authority you're doing these things. Who is the one who gave you this authority?" Jesus answered and said to them, "I will also ask you a question, and you tell me. Was the baptism of John from heaven or from men?" What's the question? Is it about John's teaching or is it about what John's doing? And the answer is, it's got to be yes, because what John was doing was baptizing people. And Jesus is asking, okay, let's talk about this baptism of John. Where was that from? Well, it's from heaven. The obvious implication here, that baptism is from heaven. What did John do about that baptism? Well, he taught people about it. So the teaching and the act were both from heaven. John wasn't making any of this stuff up as he went along. I don't know how much of his sermons, per word, per thought, were direct revelations from God. But if you think about it, would you allow John the freedom to preach in such a way that he might make a mistake in the course of his preaching? Now, this is all, once again, it's calling for speculation. But what I want us to do in the course of this class is think. Okay. When has God ever not provided a blueprint of what he expected, what he wanted? And we can look at it from a human standpoint and say, well, maybe he's doing that and it's all about legalism. No, I wasn't there. But that's right. Right. And he wasn't even full term. He was 6 months old in Elizabeth's womb. Mary comes in and 6 month old, as we would term him medically, fetus. But what kind of fetus? Human fetus? A human being fetus? Yeah, she's with child. She's not with fetus. Nobody's, oh, my wife's with fetus. By the way, the word fetus, I believe it's Latin. What's it mean? It means baby. That's what they use the word to represent. Anyway, there he is, 6 months old, and he's leaping for joy. It doesn't say that the Holy Spirit poked him and made him leap so Elizabeth would think that. He leapt for joy. Yes. Passing through to go to what's the name of that town? Should No, we're talking about John 6. Well, wait a minute. John, 6 month old in the womb, not having been born in 6 months, but 6 months old in the womb. And they didn't go to Egypt until Mary was nearly full term. Because by the time they got, not to Egypt, to Bethlehem, that's when she gave birth down there. So. Yeah, like one of those AAA triptychs where it tells you what time to go where. Excuse me. What's that? Yes. Yes. That's the claim that Luke is making there, that the Word of God came to him. Luke could have said he studied the Word of God, but he didn't say he studied the Word of God. And where would he have studied to find that in the Old Covenant? The Word of God came to him, and so he not only began baptizing people, but teaching people about that baptism. He knew what it was for. He knew what it was all about. Nobody came to John for John to say to them, I don't know why, but I'm supposed to baptize you. Why did John say he baptized? Unto repentance. Now, it's interesting to me. Yes, chronology. It's an introduction. He's preparing the way. When you go to the movies, often my favorite part of the movies is the previews, because sometimes the previews are better than what you go there to see. And what are the previews all about? They're a preview to give you a taste of what this movie is all about. And so John is out in the wilderness and he's preaching to people. It says the gospel, the euangelion, and I know sometimes there's a context in which we talk of the gospel and we say it's the death, burial, and resurrection. Who knows why we talk of the gospel as the death, burial, and resurrection? Where does that come from in Scripture? What specific text? It's 1 Corinthians 15. You can make a note of that. 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 5. John says to the church at Corinth, I preach the gospel to you. Here's what I preach to you, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. And so he identifies those three aspects of Jesus' life as the gospel. But that's not the totality of the gospel, because this text says that John is preaching the gospel, same word, euangelion, the good news of the kingdom. And so I don't think he's telling them anything about the death, burial, and resurrection here. He's saying salvation has come. That's how he puts it, or how Luke records it as him having putting it in verse 6. All flesh will see the salvation of God. Now verses 4 and 5, you read 4 and 5. Are those to be taken literally? Or are they figurative? And if they are figurative, what's the purpose of the imagery? What's that? Yeah. Now this is Luke 3, 4 and 5, where he says, as it's written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make ready the way of the Lord. Make his paths straight. What in the world does that mean? That's what I think he's telling the people. The Messiah is coming. Get yourself squared away. When you read the last few verses of the prophet Malachi, what Malachi says when he talks about John, well, go back there and take a look at it. Malachi chapter 4. Malachi says this about 400 years before Christ comes. It says, "Behold, I'm going to send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and terrible day of the Lord." Now, who was the prophet that God sent in the spirit and power of Elijah? Well, it was John the Baptist. And then Malachi says, "He will restore the hearts of the fathers to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers, so that I will not come and smite the land with a curse." So here's other prophetic words from Isaiah about the same thing. And he's saying, make his path straight. Every ravine will be filled. Every mountain and hill will be brought low. The crooked will become straight. The rough roads smooth. What's that mean? Huge change, and you better get yourself right. God is coming, not in judgment. He's coming for salvation. That's why he says in verse 6 again, all flesh will see the salvation of God. He doesn't say all flesh is going to see the judgment of God, because Jesus is coming at this point for salvation. Judgment will follow later based on the acceptance or rejection of the Messiah, but this is about the coming for salvation. Bobby. Right. There's a picture here of perfection. The valleys are going to be filled in. Everything's going to be leveled out. It's going to be a perfect plain. And I know we like mountains and hills and things like that for scenery, but we're talking about spiritual things. What are some of the physical laws in the universe that we know? There's one or two that are really obvious. What's that? Big dog wins. Well, I don't think that's exactly a scientific law. Gravity, what goes up must come down. We know there are laws of physics, and those laws are immutable. They don't change. It's, okay, what time is it? Oh, it's Wednesday night, so gravity won't be as strong tonight. No, it doesn't work that way. Gravity is a law. Everything else about the physical universe is governed by laws. Thank God, literally, for that. Because if they weren't governed by laws, everything would be in chaos. But they are governed by laws. Just as there are physical laws, there are spiritual laws. One of the reasons the world's in such chaos is because we have not paid attention to the spiritual laws. We've broken those spiritual laws, and so the whole world is a mess. I've broken those spiritual laws, and so my life is a mess. I am in turmoil with myself, and I am not alone. We all struggle, the same struggle, because we are creatures of flesh and we are creatures of spirit, and the flesh struggles against the spirit and vice versa, and we're trying to get back to what's right. And what God is picturing for us is the perfection that's going to come, not physical perfection, but spiritual perfection. I'm sending my prophet. My prophet's going to tell everybody, you make your paths straight, you get these valleys filled up and these mountains brought low, and we're going to make everything level. As Bobby says, this is salvation not just for the Jews, but for everybody. It doesn't matter how smart you are, how well-educated, how rich, how poor, you've got an opportunity for eternal life. Doesn't matter what color your skin is, who your parents are, it doesn't matter. This is for everybody. That's why when we see in the next few verses, look at verse 10. I don't want to bypass verse 9, that's huge, but to keep this context, the crowds, well, what were the crowds doing? Questioning, what were they asking? Why would they ask that? Think about it. You ever read this stuff like I do and don't even think about what it's saying and the implications, and try to put yourself back in that situation. You're in Jerusalem, and somebody says, man, you got to come with me out to the Jordan River. There's a guy out there preaching. He says the Messiah's coming. Whoa, the Messiah. We've been waiting on him 1,500 years. I know. Let's go. Come on. Get your stuff. Let's go. So you head out to the river, and he's telling you about this kingdom and about God's kingdom that's about to be established. And he says, there's one coming. I'm not even worthy to untie his sandal. I'm going to decrease. He's going to increase. You brood of vipers. And who's he talking to when he says brood of vipers? He's talking to the guys that are oppressing you with all their religious teaching, who stand on the street corners, and you can look at them and tell, oh, he's a holier-than-thou type. He thinks he's going to pray and show everybody up and make me feel how stupid I am because I don't know the book like he knows the book. He's got the book in a little box on his forehead, and his phylacteries are all this stuff. Well, John's calling those guys vipers. Well, you know they're vipers because they're hypocrites, but you can't say that because they're the leaders of Jewish religion. And so people are saying, wow, the Messiah's coming. What do we need to do? Now, they were supposed to think for themselves, but what the law had come to, I'm going to do this. I'm just going to buy one of these days, a copy of the Mishnah. Anybody ever seen a Mishnah? It's about that size, bigger than the whole Bible. The Mishnah is one of the commentaries or collections of Jewish commentaries on the law. And what was in the Mishnah was how you apply the law. It's not good enough to have the law, the first five books of the Bible. You got to have the Mishnah to tell you how it goes. Because if you got to wash your hands according to the tradition of the Pharisees, well, you got to know how much water to use. Because you got to make sure you're using enough water. Now, for us, it's not a big deal. You go in the bathroom, you turn on the faucet, you got 15 gallons an hour coming out of there. But out in the desert, you didn't have that much water. But if you're going to wash your hands sufficiently to be clean, how much water did you have to have? That was an issue. Now, can you see why Jesus comes on the scene and he's, your traditions are killing me, guys. You're making void the law of God by your traditions. But the Mishnah was full of that stuff. And the Pharisees were full of that stuff. And so the people go down to hear John, and John's saying, this is for everybody. And the people who you would think are the religious leaders, they're the vipers. And everybody says, well, yeah, I knew that, but I didn't want to say anything. What are we going to do, John? Well, John starts telling them. The man who has two tunics, what's he supposed to do? Share with the guy who has none. Now tell me that doesn't make sense. He who has food, what's he supposed to do? Share with the one that doesn't have food. Some tax collectors also came to be baptized, and they said to him, teacher, what shall we do? And John said, you stinking tax collectors work with the Romans. You're no good. Get out of my sight. What did he say? He said, collect no more than you've been ordered to do. Who was over the Jews? The Romans. Who did these guys collect taxes for? The Romans. Who put the Romans over the Jews? That was God. So, verse 14, this is interesting to me. Some soldiers were questioning him, saying, what about us? What shall we do? He said to them, you got to quit being soldiers. If you're a soldier, you might have to kill somebody, and that's not right. So you got to quit being soldiers. What did he say to them? Did he tell them to quit being soldiers? Now, think about it. If verse 14 said some thieves came to John and said, what should we do? What would John have told them? You got to quit stealing. If some fornicators came to John and said, what do we need to do? What would John have told them? You got to stop fornicating. So some soldiers come to John, and they say, what do we do? And John says, here's what you do. Don't take money from anyone by force. How did you make extra in the military? Spoils. You bullied people. You took it by force. And so John says, don't you take money from anybody by force. And then he said, Don't accuse anybody falsely. Why would you accuse somebody falsely as a soldier? Same thing, so you can have their stuff. This guy spoke out against Caesar. Ah, arrest him. Well, what's going to happen to his stuff? Well, take it. It's yours. Oh. And then he said, what was the next one? Oh, man. You know how many of us complained about our wages when I was in the military? It's interesting. Jesus, or John, is talking to soldiers, and he says, okay, don't be violent unnecessarily. Don't lie about anything. And don't be trying to get stuff from people. Be happy with your wages. He doesn't say you got to stop being soldiers. He says, if you're a soldier, you better be a soldier the way God wants you to be a soldier. And in doing so, you'll be preparing for the coming of the Messiah. Now, isn't this interesting? Soldiers, people with food, people with clothes. John doesn't say, you go build big fires and light these fires in the night. You get fireworks and you build grand temples to prepare the way for the... What's he say for these guys to do? If you got food, share it with people who don't have any food. If you've got clothes and you see somebody who doesn't have any clothes, share your clothes with them. If you're a soldier, you'll be a good soldier. You'll be the kind of soldier that people will go to for protection rather than run away from because they're afraid. It's interesting when you read about what happened in Europe in World War II. The Nazis were there for 5 years occupying a great deal of France, and they brought terror everywhere they went. Nazi soldiers were a form of terror. When the American soldiers came in, what did the people do? They flocked to them. They threw flowers at them. Girls were kissing them. I hope some of those wives back home weren't seeing these pictures of guys in Paris with women kissing them, because here are some soldiers who are coming for our good. And John is saying to these soldiers, you be that kind of soldier. This is not what soldiers were normally about. But John is saying, we're preparing the way for the Messiah, and here's how we're going to do it. We're going to change ourselves. That's right.
Jesus spoke, you read the gospel, of course, the aroma of the heart is when you really focus in on everything. You know, lust and don't commit adultery. Jesus said lust and adultery. Just heightened, fulfilled the law by heightening the standard.
It's good stuff. And it speaks to us. Have there been one bell or two? Oh, man. Okay. I got to quit then. So I'll quit. If in the course of our study you have any questions, anything you want to come back to, write it down, make a note of it. Lord willing, we'll be here next week and we can delve back into it. So thank you for your kind participation and patience.